Good morning. I've been asked to speak on use of DMARDs in management of rheumatoid arthritis. And by DMARDs, I mean conventional DMARDs, conventional disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. The present outlook of RA has really changed over the years. The disease can now be diagnosed at a very early, undifferentiated stage. The current classification criteria are highly sensitive. And now we have a wide range of therapeutic agents available. And our goal of treatment today is remission. And these are the criteria which are already now 10 years old. However, it's not inappropriate to at least mention where the shift has taken place, that you give weightage to not only the number of joints, but also which joints, small versus large. You can have 2 to 10 large joints and get only a score of 1, and you have only 1 to 3 small joints and they get twice the weightage. Similarly, in serology, it is worthwhile noting that rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP are both given equal weightage. Either of them could be positive in high titer or low titer, and you give a different scoring. If both are positive, that doesn't get additional score. So any one of these. Similarly, the duration, if it is not 6 weeks, you lose only 1. So you can make the diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis with any duration of disease. Less than 6 weeks also is possible, because you need to score 6 out of 10. And those are finer details, and I don't think I'll have time to deal with those. And it is important to remember this list of mimics of rheumatoid arthritis. So you have chikungunya, you have certain viral arthritis, other than that, lupus, other connective tissue diseases, psoriatic arthritis, reactive arthritis, spondyloarthritis, as you just heard from Dr. Malviya, polyarticular gout, hypothyroidism, osteoarthritis of hands. So often you see patients being referred as cases of rheumatoid arthritis when actually it is osteoarthritis affecting the hands. And similarly, it's important to note that there have been advances in clinical assessment of Malviya just mentioned, you know, measurements. So you have now means of measuring rheumatoid arthritis. So you have scores like DAS-28, Simplified Disease Activity Index, Clinical Disease Activity Index, and others. Similarly, American College of Rheumatology gave these ACR-20, ACR-50, ACR-70 grades of response when you treat. You have a way of measuring the disability. You have this HAQ Disability Index. We also have an Indian version of this. Similarly, you have very nice radiographic scores. So this Vander-Heide modified sharp score is very well known. So the score ranges from 0 to 448. Basically takes into account the erosions and the joint space narrowing. Then you also have well-defined remission criteria these days, and the American College of Rheumatology accepts these two definitions. One, a Boolean-based definition, which looks at tender joint count, swollen joint count, CRP value, and patient global assessment. Now you can see that the remission definition can accept one tender joint, one swollen joint, and a CRP value of less than 1 milligram per deciliter, or 10 milligrams per liter. And a patient global assessment of up to 1. But all these must be satisfied. You might say, oh, somebody has at least one swollen joint, one tender joint, but then the condition is the CRP should be less than 1. So this may look a little awkward, but actually this is true, that when you satisfy such stringent definition, patient is actually near remission. Then you also have an index-based definition of remission, and that is Simplified Disease Activity Index score less than 3.3. I will not go into details, but this is important to keep in mind. Now, coming to the topic proper, as I mentioned, there are so many options available now, And these pharmacological agents can be categorized into NSAIDs and analgesics, one group. Disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, where you have the conventional synthetic DMARDs, you have the biologicals, you have these small molecules, the third category that has got added. Strictly speaking, the small molecules or kinase inhibitors can be also categorized under conventional synthetic DMARDs because they are not biologics. They are synthesized molecules. Now, steroids are still kept under a separate category, although, as we'll talk about, they also are disease-modifying. Now, moving on to the conventional disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. Over the years, we have really obtained a long list of disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs, but this color is actually changed now. Something has happened. But the right-hand side, you know, okay. Over here it is looking the way I desired. So these are almost outmoded now. Hardly anyone uses this. Although in the 80s, we used to really strongly recommend and use things like deep penicillamine and oral gold, injectable gold and whatnot, all full of side effects. So they have fallen by the side because of the unacceptable toxicity pattern. So, literally speaking, it is the top four in this column which are the commonly used conventional disease-modifying drugs. And these are, you can say, miscellaneous, which we use sometimes. When we talk of anti-malarial, it is hydroxychloroquine, not really chloroquine. Gone are those days when we used to prescribe chloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine is the drug because of its better toxicity profile. It's a slow drug, rarely used alone, rarely used as a monotherapy. So mainly adjunct role, but still it is not abundant, it is important. It does add value to the treatment. The dose is 400 milligram per day for 3 months, and then you reduce it to 200 milligram. I often see prescriptions of, you know, patients taking 400 milligram forever, which is quite disturbing because then it can really cause toxicity, which we want to avoid. Adverse drug reactions include rash, hyperpigmentation, pruritus, nausea, anorexia, retinopathy. If you are giving a combination of drugs to somebody and then he says that I have lost all appetite, I have got complete aversion, first suspect hydroxychloroquine. Sometimes it does cause this kind of side effect. Don't suspect methotrexate, that never causes. It is hydroxychloroquine that will cause complete anorexia. Now, the thing that is important about hydroxychloroquine is the ocular toxicity, because of which so many physicians will probably avoid prescribing it. Now, I just want to reiterate that the American Academy of Ophthalmology recommends maximum daily dose of 5 milligram per kilogram per day. And the risk of toxicity mentioned variably in different publications. So I'll just mention a few things. That up to 5 years, the risk is less than 1%. Up to 10 years, it is less than 2%. But it rises to almost 20% after 20 years. However, a recent study from the US, from Cleveland to be more specific, I've given the reference at the bottom. They looked at their data, and out of 2,867 patients who had taken hydroxychloroquine for a mean duration of 5.9 years, that is about 6 years, there were only 3 cases who developed HCQS retinopathy of significance. And these 3 had actually taken hydroxychloroquine for more than 18 years, but then they had no functional loss of vision. So that's interesting, that they had the evidence on retinal evaluation, but they had not yet lost vision. So basically it is reassuring that don't be obsessed with retinopathy. In the first 5 years, nothing happens. After that, annual eye checkup is recommended. Now, what are the tests for hydroxychloroquine retinopathy? The primary screening tests are standardized automated perimetry as opposed to manual. Now you have, you know, the machine does all this. and spectral domain optical coherence tomography. These are the two primary screening tests which are to be done annually. And it is said that in Asian patients, one should look beyond the central macula. The secondary screening tests include multifocal electroretinogram and fundus autofluorescence. Next, I move on to sulfasalazine. Now, interestingly, this is a drug which was specifically developed for rheumatoid arthritis by a Swedish rheumatologist, Professor Nana Schwartz, in the 1940s. It is started at a small dose and increased to 2 to 3 grams per day. The monitoring is simple, monthly complete blood count and liver enzymes for 3 months, and then once every 3 months. And once tolerated for 2 years, actually no further blood monitoring is needed. However, it's important that since it is a sulfa, you should keep in mind that don't prescribe it to somebody with a previous history of sulfa allergy, and also be vigilant about it at the earliest. If you have suspicion that the person has allergy, must withdraw it. Other important side effect is GI intolerance and oligospermia. Now, it's important to note that oligospermia is mentioned in textbooks as an uncommon side effect, something to the tune of 3 to 4%. Actually, one recent study, well, it's not very recent, this is 1981 actually, but anyway, it caught my attention because they found that out of 28 patients who were systematically looked into, 28 males, 18 had problems with sperm count, sperm motility, thereby actually contributing to infertility. So be very, very, careful about somebody who is young and you have prescribed sulfasalazine and actually they are undergoing tests for infertility. And I mean, it is actually embarrassing that person comes back to you and tells that the gynecologist has said, you know, nothing wrong with the lady. This man has oligospermia, and that's why we should be aware of this, that this is not an infrequent problem. It is not rare at all. Methotrexate, I think all facts are very well known, and I really don't need to read what I've given on this slide. Practically everyone understands this. So the current doses are 15 to 25 milligrams per week. There is no doubt that parenteral route has better bioavailability. However, not everybody requires injections. Most patients will be able to absorb the required dose. And if you start with oral, you will end up giving injections to not more than 10-15% of patients. Most of them will be able to manage on oral. For the nausea, you have various options. And Dr. Malviya has popularized coffee to prevent nausea due to methotrexate. It does work, and many times it doesn't work, but it is worth a trial. If a patient is having intolerance to methotrexate, a cup of strong coffee before taking methotrexate and maybe a while later also repeating it does work for some patients. Now, methotrexate has several side effects, including stomatitis, oral ulcers, transaminitis. In the long run, a bit of hepatic fibrosis can occur, skin rash, infections. However, these may look scary, but we don't see them commonly. The liver risk factors are obesity, diabetes, and alcohol abuse. So you need to be observant on that and avoid where it's appropriate. There are American College of Rheumatology guidelines on monitoring of methotrexate hepatotoxicity, which are well published. We'll talk about that. Methotrexate pneumonitis is rarely seen. It is a hypersensitivity pneumonitis. The reported incidence is 1 in 200. So once in a while you see, but then it happens generally in the first few weeks after starting methotrexate, or maybe a few months, but generally not beyond 6 months. Contraindications to methotrexate are very well known. I really don't need to mention here. Relative contraindication is renal impairment, but sometimes with mild renal impairment, we are able to use modified doses of methotrexate. but one has to be careful. What about hepatotoxicity monitoring? The liver enzymes and albumin should be monitored monthly for 3 months, and after that once in 2 to 3 months. If an abnormal test result is obtained, you should decrease the methotrexate dose and repeat the blood test in 2 to 4 weeks. If the level is more than twice the upper limit of normal, then it is good to withhold methotrexate for up to 2 weeks. If the enzymes remain elevated, look for other causes. Many times it is fatty liver, sometimes person may be actually suffering from a viral infection, and at other times it may be autoimmune hepatitis itself associated. So then it requires investigation. However, if no other cause is found and you suspect it is methotrexate only, then best is to withdraw it for good. But how common is methotrexate hepatotoxicity? Elevated transaminases are seen in about 20% of patients who are taking methotrexate. However, levels more than twice upper limit of normal are reported to vary from 1% to 13% in different studies. What about methotrexate-associated cirrhosis? Does it occur? Well, the current estimates are 2 in 5,000 after 10 years of use. So it's exceedingly uncommon, but it does occur. One should know that it does occur, but it's not common at all. But wherever you have suspicion, you can do appropriate investigations, but routine biopsies are not recommended. We don't recommend biopsies after, you know, 1.5 gram has been administered or 2 grams has been administered. That is not the correct approach. What about folic acid supplementation? You might have seen prescriptions of rheumatologists. Somebody writes 5 milligram folic acid per week to be prescribed along with methotrexate. Somebody writes one tablet daily, 6 days in a week. So what is correct? What is the right thing to do? So this was sorted out by our colleague Varun Dheer from PGI Chandigarh in an elegant study, where he showed that whether you give 10 milligrams of folic acid per week or you give 30 milligrams per week, it doesn't make a difference. The two achieve the same outcome. Even the efficacy is not affected, and nor are the adverse effects any different. So you can use just 5 milligrams twice a week. But everybody uses his own regimen. What about leflunomide? Now this is, you can say, a cousin of methotrexate, came from oncology, didn't work there, and was adopted in rheumatology because it was useful for rheumatoid arthritis. It is an anti-metabolite. The adverse reactions that it can cause are skin rashes, GI toxicity, liver toxicity, alopecia. Remember, sometimes patients come back with severe weight loss, and this is not very rare, up to 7%. I used to believe 5%, but this is 7% is from a study which I just found in the literature. So 5 to 7% people can lose up to 20 kilos in 3 months. So if that kind of thing is happening and person is scared, my God, I've got some malignancy and he's getting workup done, please hold on. Just withdraw your leflunomide and things will be fine. The dosage is 20 milligram daily. The caution to be used here is that it is best to avoid it in people contemplating pregnancy. So in women, just don't prescribe if they are planning pregnancy. The drawback with this drug is that it accumulates in the body and you need an elimination protocol with cholestyramine, which is given for 11 days. To get rid of it, because it just gets deposited in the system. So I've talked about negative things of leflunomide, but actually it's a wonderful drug. And the advantage with it is that it is nearly as effective as methotrexate, although it doesn't have the flexibility of different dose. You can either give 20 or you can maybe reduce it to 10. But the important thing is in kidney compromise, when the kidney function is poor, this is the only drug which will be useful. So you can use it in patients who have got CKD. Next, cyclosporin. So cyclosporin is the drug that gave us for the first time the understanding of what T cell is doing in rheumatoid inflammation. Cyclosporine monotherapy has limited role in rheumatoid management, but it is safe in pregnancy. So when it is to be used for a short period, like in pregnancy, this can be given. Combination of cyclosporine with methotrexate is great. It is efficacious even for resistant cases of rheumatoid arthritis. And this is all published in the literature. You have to adopt a go low and go slow approach with regard to cyclosporine. Don't start maximum dose from day one. Start and build up the dose over some time. The risk of nephrotoxicity is low if you follow the guidelines strictly and monitor for any rise in creatinine. If there is more than 30% rise in the serum level of creatinine from baseline, that's an indication to withdraw it. Tacrolimus, another calcineurin inhibitor, is also a useful drug for disease modification in rheumatoid arthritis. At 3 milligrams per day, ACR20 rates of about 50% are achieved. Methotrexate plus tacrolimus combination is superior to monotherapy. Tacrolimus again is a drug that can be used safely in pregnancy. The adverse drug reactions which are common are GI and renal, which I just mentioned. So nephrotoxicity here also is an important side effect. Lastly, I come to this drug called Iguratimod or Mimod. This is the only brand that is available. It has just been introduced in India. Actually, it has been in use in Japan and China since 2012. But in India, it has been introduced only recently. I have had the chance to prescribe it to probably half a dozen patients only, and I still can't tell you any opinion on this because it requires time. But from my knowledge, I can say that it is supposed to be equivalent to sulfasalazine in terms of efficacy. So besides its disease-modifying effect, it is anabolic on the bone. So that's another advantage with this drug. It down-regulates several mediators like NF-kappa-B, IL-6, TNF-alpha, IL-17, COX-2. The dose is simple, 25 milligrams per day to start with, and then after a month, make it 25 milligram twice a day. Adverse drug reactions, nausea, headache, pruritus, transaminitis. Important thing is that it can be combined with methotrexate with advantage. So you have another option available now. What is the place of steroids? I'm just going to come to end of my talk. As I mentioned, steroids do possess disease modifying effects. Adverse effect profile, however, is unacceptable in the long term. Short-term use in early RA is recommended. You can use it up to 6 months. Generally, we use it for much shorter period because our disease-modifying drugs take over. So this is called bridge therapy. You're just bridging the gap when your other agents, which are slow, are taking effect. But intra-articular steroid injections are, of course, very popular, very commonly used, and they are effective. Systemic steroid has limited indications in rheumatoid arthritis, namely vasculitis, interstitial lung disease, serositis. Lastly, I come down to the latest recommendations from the American College of Rheumatology on the approach to use of disease-modifying drugs. The essence actually is, you know, these have not yet been published, but you can get an executive summary on the internet from the ACR site. So essentially, they are dividing approach to early rheumatoid, which is less than 6 months in duration, and established rheumatoid, which is either already more than 6 months or disease which satisfies our old criteria, 1987 criteria, not the current ACR Euler criteria. Now, for early rheumatoid arthritis, what they say is that a treat-to-target strategy is to be preferred. That means you have to have a target. What do you want to achieve? The target is either remission proper, as I mentioned the criteria, or at least low disease activity. So one of these two must be achieved. Rarely you may choose a different target because of force of circumstances, a patient is not able to tolerate any of the available drugs or maybe some other reasons, but those will be exceptional. Secondly, For a person who is naive to any disease-modifying therapy and has early symptomatic disease, what ACR recommends is a monotherapy, preferably with methotrexate. So they are not saying that you start with combination right from beginning. Try first monotherapy with methotrexate rather than double or triple. And then if in this early disease person still has active disease despite methotrexate, then all options open up with no kind of order of preference. You can go for combination disease modifying drugs, conventional. You can combine with a TNF biologic, anti-TNF biologic, or you can use a non-TNF biologic, in no order of preference. Of course, in India, also because of the cost factors, we will first try conventional disease modifying drugs.
Methotrexate is the anchor drug. This methotrexate is not the same which you treat cancer with. That's a different drug. The metabolism is different. The site of action is different. Low dose methotrexate produces adenosine and suppresses cytokines, while the high dose methotrexate stops with JN synthesis. So these are two very different drugs. You use this drug, which is safest. Prolonged treatment can be given without any problem. Its retention rate is the highest among most of the common drugs in the world. Safest. And it does not produce side effects in the lungs. This is very true. So use this. But in addition, we don't agree with what ACR says in India. The reason is we are the epicenter of metabolic syndrome. Diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol, obesity is a major issue in India. And if you read hydroxychloroquine, now three major trials are going on. Two have been published from India as treatment for diabetes. It also helps bring down the lipids, as well as it is antiplatelet. It stops thrombus formation also, and therefore, and in addition, it is anti-inflammatory. It protects liver damage against methotrexate. So therefore, because of its multifarious wonderful action, I love to combine it with methotrexate. And in the API textbook of medicine, my chapter of rheumatoid, I have mentioned that we will be giving methotrexate, but we will always add hydroxychloroquine along with it.